probably. We looked at the tackling different membranes in vitreoretinal surgery, and I guess half of the hall was made out of medical retina specialists who are on their way out or who have left, and we'll get on with the vitreoretinal specialist. So if I can have the esteemed panel on this stage, Dr. Rajesh, he is setting up the mic, setting up his laptop. Dr. Amod is already here. Dr. Saravanan will join us soon. And instead of Dr. Rohan Chawla, it will be Dr. Divyansh, because Dr. Rohan is not able to make it to the meeting here. So we'll start with the simplest of the membranes, which would be a peritoneal membrane. But though we think it is simple, it need not be all the time. And Dr. Rajesh will speak to us about the epimacular membranes, various types, manifestation, and management. There has been recent explosion of knowledge as far as the different types of epimacular membrane and how there can be a difference in how you manage them. So let's get on with the first talk. Dr. Rajesh, please.
Mike. Good morning, one and all. So I'll be, my talk for the day for 10 minutes is epimacular membrane, the various types, manifestations, and management. So Foos were the first to etiologically classify it. The first two he did describe, saying it was primary where there was no etiological factor as such, idiopathic or age-related. And the second was secondary because of various causes which predisposes the eye to go into an inflammatory state and form the macular membranes. The recent one, there has been an acronym which is called as LHEP, that is lamellar hole associated epiretinal proliferation, which has come into the recent years from the past 2 years. I'll just deal with that also. So when look into the etiology part of it, as Foos had already given, the idiopathic, which is, I'll prove over a period of the next few slides about the age-related, and the secondary, which is a gamut of various intraocular conditions like retinal vein occlusion, inflammatory conditions like uveitis, tumor-associated, any intraocular surgeries, inclusive of VR surgeries, or cryo or laser can predispose to the formation of epimacular membranes. So as far as the epidemiology is concerned, when we look at eyes more than 50 years having epimacular membranes, about 2% in international literature. And when we step up that age criteria to 75 years, it becomes 20%. So it's an indirect evidence to suggest that these idiopathic membranes are more so age-related. Other common ones like macular pucker, which is commonly seen in post-VR surgery, especially retinal detachment surgery, is about 3 to 8.5%. Bilateral cases, one eye, if you have an idiopathic macular membrane, there's a high probability that the other eye might also have. It's about 20 to 30% of the cases. So one of the first clinical criteria for this was given by GAS. This was to grade the patient and to see whether the patient needs a surgical intervention or not. He divided into three simple stages. Grade zero, which is a transparent, what we call as cellophane maculopathy, with no visual consequences. The patient comes for a daily routine examination and you tend to pick up this membrane. A grade one, where you have a fine retinal folds, patient might complain of some amount of metamorphopsia. The grade two are the ones which the GAS recommended for surgical intervention, where there is a marked distortion and wrinkling of the retina, which causes secondary changes in the retina, which includes hemorrhages, edema of the retina, cotton wool spots, and localized serous detachment. So how do we generally deal with this membrane? This is all well known, but I'm just repeating it. So one of the first which most of us do nowadays is, which has already been talked about in the previous IC, where we generally go and stain the posterior pole with the BBG, and there is a positive area of staining and a negative area. The negative area is generally the ERM. So what we do is we start with the positive stained area, that's the ILM, and peel all across the fovea. So it takes care of both the ILM as well as the ERM per se. So the general extent of peeling would be as good as the ERM. So you need not do an extensive peeling like in giant macular holes. So an area sufficient enough to cover the ERM is good enough. Or you can go in the conventional way, which was taught to us. First, you identify one of the edge of the epimacular membrane, lift it up gently with a 24-gauge needle or a barbed MVR blade, and then go and peel it all across the macula. Once you finish this, then you stain the residual ILM over there with the BBG and then do the ILM peeling. ILM peeling came into vogue to prevent the recurrence of epimacular membrane, which was very well taken up by all of us. I'll just come to the other evidences which goes against it. So this completes the surgery of ILM peeling along with the ERM. So what if there is a macular hole, if there is an epimacular membrane along with a macular hole concomitant? Nowadays, there is a statement which even my boss keeps telling, that macular hole has become a dustbin surgery, so whatever you get, you go and fill it up. So what we call as inverted flap, we are trying to extrapolate it in putting all sorts of membranes. So even these days, we can try and put the epimacular membrane also. This is a patient who has a macular hole concomitant with an ERM. So what basically I'm doing is peeling the ILM and the ERM together and taking it to the center and leaving it as so that it acts as a scaffold for the macular hole to close upon. So you don't need a separate tissue. It's not that you peel the ERM, then you peel the ILM and stuff the ILM. You can stuff the ERM. It's not basically stuffing. It's just overlaying onto the macular hole and leaving it with gas. So basically, essentially, it completes the surgery, do an air fluid exchange, and leave for the scaffold to act for the macular hole to close. So a big dilemma or the question which has risen up, we have n number of articles to support that if you peel the ILM along with your ERM, definitely the recurrence rate comes down drastically. There's already comparison trials saying that about 70-20% of the ERM recur if the ILM is not peeled. But at the same moment, we have now recent articles saying that if you peel in every case, there are these end-phase imaging of these patients when we do, there is large amount of these lacunae which appear. These are folds, and when they prospectively saw this patient even after 6 months to a year, these lacunae became greater, larger, and they, when the microperimetry was done, they showed us larger scotomas corresponding to these areas. So a big question comes into play whether you really have to peel or you don't have to peel. The advantage what they say is like since these scotomas don't come up and only about 70%, 17% are the recurrence rate, you just leave it as such. Or whatever that has been passively peeled when during the ERM, you can just complete it and leave it as such rather than peeling actively. So it's again a controversy, not yet been proved. Coming to secondary ERMs, this is one which Mahesh sir has operated. This patient has a combined hematoma of the retina and retinal pigment epithelium. The few things which I would like to highlight in secondary membranes is, the problem is it is very adherent, densely adherent, so peeling is a bit difficult. You can get bleeding, abnormal bleeding also when you are trying to peel it. And the sub-peeling may not be complete. You might have to use other unconventional things which may not be required, like bimanual surgery in ERM, which we usually don't do in other idiopathic cases, and scissors also, which sir will be using in this, to delaminate the membrane from the underlying retina. So this is the pre and post operative. Hardly you can see any configurational changes as far as the retina is concerned, but the tractional pull and the disintegration of the internal inner retina can be well appreciated because of the CHRRP secondary membrane. A new classification has come up, which is the OCT-based classification, which they are divided into grade 1, 2, 3, and 4, based upon the presence or absence of ectopic foveal inner retinal membranes at the fovea. So the more the traction by these membranes, the more the ectopic inner retinal which is there at the fovea. That causes the poor prognostic of the vision. So this is one of the representative cases. This becomes a grade 4 FL. So what they say, they have suggested is if it's more than grade 3, it's better to do a surgical intervention along with it, given steroid implant so that the contour attains much earlier and the visual prognosis is a little bit better as compared to surgery alone. The newer terminology which I wanted to spend a little bit more time upon, this is called as a LHEP. So LHEP is nothing but it's similar to an epiretinal proliferation, but different as compared to the ERM per se. It is a thick, homogeneous, medium reflective membrane. It's epiretinal. The margins of the lamellar defect is where we usually find it, and it's a non-tractional, as contrary to the ERM which we have already studied. So the prevalence is approximately high indices, they have quoted about 30%. I have rarely seen them. I've just seen very closely after coming across this acronym about 4 to 5 cases in my clinical practice till date. The LHM may be associated with ERM or LHEP or both individually. So what is the difference? The most important difference that I would highlight is in the ERM, the underlying retina is thrown into folds and there is a skip areas of contact and the cystoid spaces. As far as LHEP, there is no traction and it is tightly adherent to the underlying retina. So this is a representative image. The upper one is the LHEP where you can see that the membrane is coming from the inner aspect of the hole and then growing onto the retina over there. As far as the epimacular membrane is concerned, it's pulling the fovea contour on either side. Theories is they say that it's vitreous in origin or Müller cellular in origin. Both of them, it doesn't really say that. But when we do an histopathological analysis, it's more of a glial cell proliferation is what we have seen. So our experience, I would just try run a video. So this is a stained membrane. You could see that it's very, very thick and very adherent. Sorry for the poor quality of recording for this video. It's very thick, very adherent, and you feel as if you are pulling out the inner retinal layers also along with this membrane when we are peeling. So this was the post-operative images. There's another patient with retinitis pigmentosa with LHEP in bilateral. So to conclude, epimacular membrane is a well-established criteria. There is criteria for diagnosis, OCT staging, as well as intervention, when to intervene and not. Only controversy exists whether to peel the ILM actively or not. As far as secondary epimacular membranes are concerned, the only issue is it's not easy to remove, and you have to be ready with adherent tissue to the underlying retina, and usually incomplete. LHEP has now emerged as a distinct clinical entity. Progression, the LHEP increases, the lamellar hole also increases, increasing the EZ defects and decrease in vision. It's very challenging to peel these membranes because of the strong adherence to the underlying retina. And some reports have come out as favorable anatomical outcomes, as well as many of them have shown that there is no favorable outcomes with this peeling of this membrane, so they advocate just to leave it as such. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. Are there any questions or comments on Dr. Rajesh? Yes.
I would like to ask that why do we remove these two together, which is what is the thing, because they too are of different etiopathology. ILM is a straight membrane which is part of your normal retina, and ERM does have tentacles, it has got not a fixed structure. And if you try to remove these two things together, you are likely to be causing traction at some place, causing a iatrogenic issues. So I would like to have the expert opinion. I prefer it separately. I remove the ERM and then go for the ILM.
Yeah, I would, Dr. Rajesh, you want to answer that? It depends on how thick the ERM is. If it's a very thick ERM where you would want to probably, it comes off easily by identifying it, removing it, then you would remove it separately and then the ILM separately. But there are situations when it's just a cellophane kind of a maculopathy where you don't know where to grasp it. At that point of time, you stain it and start using the ILM as a handle, then you can peel it across and then use it, and then the ERM comes along with that. If there are no further questions or comments, we'll go on to the next talk, which will be by Dr. Pramod. He'll be talking to us on an important topic of PVR, managing PVR. The LHEP is a new term which seems to indicate there is a retina which is growing, there's a kind of a glial tissue or whatever that word, tissue was which is growing into the lamellar hole. So when we peel it, it seems to indicate it's part of the retina on histopathological studies, but then overall consensus is there is an improvement in vision in these patients if you do the surgery. But then you need to identify that there is a lamellar hole with the LHEP before we attempt surgery on these patients.
Good afternoon, and thanks, Mahesh, for having me here. Yeah, so I'll try. Basically, it's supposed to be more like a video base. We'll try to restrict probably just to minimal videos. So basically, topic is for PVR membranes, old RD. So basically, when you look at a fresh RD, typically what you have an elevated opaque retina, which undulates and have some wrinkling, have a darker blood vessels. If you see here, breaks may not be visible sometime, small tiny peripheral breaks, and occasionally you can have tobacco dusting, we'll go a little bit later on. But as against when you see old detachments, it's a broad spectrum of clinical challenges. Retina can be thin, atrophic, transparent, as you see here. You have intraretinal cyst, again indicates long-standing RD. You have subretinal glial band or reproliferation extensive, or you can have, again, indication like spontaneous reattachment, which shows it's an old RD. You can have further down, you have demarcation line here. You can diffuse PVR. And the same eye, because of long-standing detachment, what you saw is iris neovascularization. The vessels are proliferating right on the lens. These are few typically very, very old detachments when you see. So the basic pathogenesis, what it is it's an exaggerated wound healing response leading to growth and contraction of cellular membranes in the vitreous cavity on both retinal surfaces, which leads to foreshortening of the retina, causes traction, and probably it can create tear the retina, creating new breaks, or it can just open up pre-existing break, and it's one of the commonest cause, almost 75% cases of failure for a surgery due to for the RD. The basic classification, what we have, right range of clinical manifestation. What you know is just A, B, and C. Just to complete the list, what you have, sort of tobacco dusting. You go with a dusting here, and then you have a and typically what we talk about, rolled edges of the membrane, that's a grade B. And grade C, where you have a varied presentation depending on, basically it's a membrane, both anterior and posterior surface of the retina. It can be anterior, posterior, focal, what you see sometime here, or diffuse here, or anterior, posterior, both things are involved. That's extensive, different spectrum of the PVR. So most of these eyes, we need to do vitrectomy and not amenable for scleral buckling. About early and late membranes, we'll come to that later on. When you decide to operate, the decision making, generally if you're planning buckle, then you open maybe 360 degree, it's conjunctival opening. But I'm not planning to buckle, then these are the just standard steps, go with a three-port passpanel vitrectomy and sequentially. But I'm going to restrict mostly to removal of these retinal membranes here, so in these presentations. So basically, what you are looking at it is to relieve all the traction on the mobile retina, or to make the retina mobile, what it is like this, we want it something like this. The traction is relieved, whole thing is open up. You compare these two pictures, the same eye, and at the end, and then this is the time where you want to do your fluid erection, close the brakes, and settle the retina. Now, instrument gauge is a surgeon's discretion. Techniques, again, depending on location, extent, and vascularity of the membrane. You can use bimanual or unimanual technique depending on retinal mobility and depending on location of the membranes again. So, yes, most of these PVR eyes, they have a PVD present, but when you have a pediatric age group dealing with, sometimes it can be a nightmare for you. Look at this eye. I use a tricot eventually, but almost 45 minutes it took for me to get the edge of posterior hyaloid separating from the disc and subsequently peeling it off. Sometimes it can be very, very difficult. So coming to membranes per se, if you have a focal, you are lucky enough, it is right on the posterior pole. Generally what you do is create the edge with either your pick or even cutter or forceps, as per whatever way you are comfortable with. And once you have an edge, you can hold with the forceps and peel tangential to the retina, as you see here, and just coming out, minimize the traction. As against, this is retina is a little bit mobile. You start dissection generally at the disc because that is, you have a fulcrum and help you to have a counter traction. And as it moves forward, you keep on going, but as retina is more mobile, it's difficult to grasp and have a counter traction. As you see, whole retina is getting pulled up. So you try as far as possible tangential to the retina and pull from disc towards the periphery. Then only you'll be able to peel this membrane. Otherwise, whole thing get pulled off. You will not be able to separate this type of membrane from the retina. And when you immature membranes, practically you can't see the membranes on this retina here, but pattern this fixed fold, retinal like a sheen on the vessels and mobility of the retina probably clue for you, and keep on you sort of massage or ticking here and just struggle here and there. Use a visual instrument you are comfortable with, and eventually you see get this age. If you have a lot of pigment dispersion, that's another clue for you that there are some membranes there. And you, as you keep on peeling, you get this age, and eventually see the membranes is almost transparent here. But unless you remove this retina, either will not settle, or even if settles, these membranes are going to have reproliferation, and patient will come back with recurrences. Very, very important to you need to for you to get these membranes off before you make an attempt to reattach this retina. So visualization is extremely difficult, and you again have to keep on looking for it, keep on working around it. Ultimately, you will be able to get this thing out. But some, when you are dealing with a sort of mobile retina or have a peripheral membrane or even posterior membranes are very, very tough, you need to use biomanual technique. Here I am practically holding retina with a forceps and peeling this up. This is a 20 gauge case, let me tell you, spatula as you see here. And here I am using a biomanual. And the look at here, I am not peeling the membrane. What I am doing is holding the membrane with the forceps and pressing the retina back. Because the membrane is tough, if I pull the membrane here, retina will tear off. So hold the membrane and pressing the retina back. Go back, grasp again, push the retina back. And that's the way I could peel this membrane, not just pulling the membrane away from the retina. And this is what happened. If you try to pull straight up, what you do is either you tear the retina somewhere here, or and then I grasped the blood vessel and pulled up, and this is what had happened. So this is what we do not want to do, how not to peel. Basically, again, probably this is a typical, the same continuation of the case, previous case. You hold the membrane, tap the retina back, go grasp it rather than landing iatrogenic problem. This is, again, one of those bad cases. Combined PK, trauma, and as extremes, these are other extremes. So obviously, you need a biomanual dissection. This is a blotch of cataract surgery where the retina, you look at this, what it is, and ultimately need a biomanual. These are the membranes to peel. Retina has become mobile, so you, unless you hold with a hand, other hand, you will not be able to peel this off. This again, try to just press the retina back, holding the membrane one hand and pressing the retina. Ultimately, we did 360 RR this case and try to settle down to some extent. Vision obviously will be extremely guarded or poor these eyes, but you just have to settle. Once you are inside, you can't just leave it like that. Coming to subretinal membranes, so generally either you can have a, depending on where the location of the membrane, fine. So here was just like a one single band which I pulled it off, but here the extensive entire sheet was there in subretinal space. So eventually you needed 360 degree RR, but what you do is here you don't want to do 360 degree to start with. Just open one quadrant, because the attached retina or at the aura somewhere holding it on, that acts as a counter traction, get membrane out of these subretinal membranes, then open some other side, roll it up. So sometimes you can do 1, 2, 3 retinotomies, or sometimes 360 degree retinotomy. As you see here, there was a napkin ring around to peel this up. But let me tell you that not all the subretinal membranes you need to remove. If it is not crossing under the fovea, if it is not somewhere near break, and if you can support peripheral membrane along with buccal, probably you can get away with that. Also, those are the eyes where you have only membrane and you can support with the buccal, probably they do better. Also, you need not remove the entire membrane. One edge you snap. Other edge, even if it's attached, the traction is relieved. Probably this membrane settles down. You really do not have to go behind it entirely. So there are adjoint steps we need to do, something like buccal if you have peripheral traction. And these are, again, one of the extreme things. Relaxing retinotomy, if there is a diffuse equatorial traction or retinal foreshortening, then you have to resort. But when you do this, this is probably like a, generally as a last resort, as a routine, you do not want to do this. And this is again, I thought Rajesh would have covered. So basically, but then this is typically reproliferation under silicon oil, epiretinal membrane. What I wanted to look at is something is difficult to get the edge. because age is far peripheral than what you visualize actually, and the direction of pull matters here really. So once you remove the oil, see the I use MVR blade to create edge first, and then when you peel, look at this. When he is pulling here, you can see the edge here. So you leave it here, go back, hold this end, pull, go back this end, and then go more like a circumferential. So when you want to pull here, look at this. The edge is somewhere here, not actually where I hold it. See the transmitter. So you need to keep an eye on it. So go back here and then start. If you try to pull here, this end and this end get pulled, you may create a iatrogenic problem here. So here you pull it off. Now it is pulling. So go somewhere pulling tangentially, but at like this direction so that it get pulled this way. Here it's coming up, it's pulled off. You see the edge is here. So I need to hold here. I cannot pull here. If I pull directly here, this will just tear it off. So hold where the edge is and keep on moving in a tangential direction. Separate all around the disc if it is there, and then get this thing side out. I think that's probably the last thing. So to conclude, in detail RDs, periretinal membranes are predominantly due to exaggerated healing response, making retina stiff and immobile. Meticulous removal of all these membranes over entire retina is crucial to remobilize the retina for successful reattachment and to minimize recurrence of detachments. And choice of the instruments is again surgeon's discretion. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Pramod, for the wonderful videos and the talk. So I see that in many of your surgeries, you have not used perfluorocarbon. So when would you use a perfluorocarbon to keep the posterior retina like in place when you dissect anteriorly?
Most of the cases, probably we can manage without using perfluorocarbons. Yeah, but when you are aiming to do relaxing retinotomy, and particularly you have peripheral membranes where retina is very, very mobile, and then you need a counter traction. So those situations, probably you use a partial filling perfluorocarbon to hold the posterior pole in place and then peel the membrane off periphery. But before putting perfluorocarbon, just ensure that there are no posterior breaks. Particularly if you're working on the retina, peripheral retina, and you have posterior break and you add perfluorocarbon, so transmitted traction, sometimes it goes under the retina, then it's more nuisance. You will have to do large retinotomy, reflect the retina and get that perfluorocarbon out. That can be difficult. But yes, bad PVR, GRT particularly, giant retina and tears, and they are obviously to, when once you clear the posterior pole, have a retina mobilized. Most important, you have a posterior hyaloid separated. Ensure that there is no, like a posterior hyaloid is not, they are adherent to the disc, around the disc, and you put PFCL over, then things become difficult for you to separation. So ensure posterior hyaloid is separated, clear the posterior pole, reasonably mobile, add perfluorocarbon, and then want to peel peripheral membrane. There are situation membranes, sometimes retina is very tight, you have something like a napkin ring, posterior pole is tightly closed. So very rarely to start with, to find the plane, initially maybe you put little bit small bubble of perfluorocarbon which sinks through in, gives some working space for you, and then you work your way, find your way through.
Yeah, in one of the cases, Dr. Pramod had shown the pediatric case, one of the techniques is you can make a small hole in the posterior hyaloid and inject the perfluorocarbon through that under the PHF, and then sometimes it kind of induces the PVD. Yes, sir.
You said that every subretinal band may not be removed. Which one you do not indicate that it should be removed? One thing. Second thing is, I have been trying a different way. You do a large retinotomy, pull it up. I used to, whenever you see this kind of band, single band going in one quadrant, you just make a small nick on the top and then just pull it out from there.
That's what first video did not play.
Because I didn't play
that. Either one or two, depending on where the break is.
Yes.
Just make a tiny opening, go through that, hold that band, single band, and pull that out. That didn't play first video actually.
And which bands you may leave behind? Because you said every band we need to be removed.
So bands where probably they are peripheral.
No, we see it. So it is like nasal bands. Huh? Nasal retina bands or something like that.
I won't say nasal or temporal. Yes, obviously temporal, where the band does not allow your macula to fall back. Band running across the break. Obviously, you need to snap those or remove those.
True.
But suppose, like a typical example, I said injury case, blunt trauma, long-standing RD. We have multiple bands. Probably first picture what I showed where this corner one,
sure,
where young age. There's no PVD, there are bands, dialysis which can easily be supported with the buckle. Little bit elevation will be there at the end of surgery, but these are the eyes over a period of time very nicely settled down. They look bad, but they settle on extremely well. Rather, I would say buckle is the best option in those eyes rather than messing up.
Earlier, the concept used to be that like you wait for the immature PVR to become mature. Do you do that now, or would you go in and operate?
Most because it is a trade between the longer macula remains detached, we know functional outcome is poorer. With previously, again, we used to do that because we did not have good visualization system, not a wide-angle visualization system, illumination systems were not that great. So the disadvantage of having a premature membrane is while peeling sometime, because visibility is poor, you may leave those behind and they reproliferate. The thicker, broad membrane, mature membranes, visibility is good, and they come, once you get the edge, they can come entire thing as a nice single sheet. So technically surgery become easier, and that's why you all of us probably started read the book with Steve Charles, Fast Talks about wait till 1 month till membranes get mature and then remove. I don't think we follow most of us. Now what we look at is the functional outcome is more important. Probably earlier you go in, functionally you are better off, and because of good instrumentation, because of visualization systems are far better, you can reach periphery very easily. Most of us prefer not to wait nowadays.
Yeah, towards this, there is a recently described technique of using the Miracil sponge. The Miracil sponge, the spheres which people use for the LASIK surgery, you can use them to, you can hold them with the forceps and go inside what we call as a vitreous wiping technique. So you can use this to wipe the vitreous towards the periphery. And like this, we have seen that it works for even immature membranes. You can go, Dr. Divyansh is going to show a video of that.
Starting that Fenny's loop now and then staining with the
ICG.
Yeah,
this one, like what happens is the surface area is larger, so it tends to grasp the vitreous in a much
better,
larger area and seems to peel
easy
off.
To pick up.
So thanks, Dr. Pramod. Next, I'll be speaking. Yes, please.
If the patient had a old retinal detachment along with the macular hole, do you think that island peeling in that case under PFCL is better or no?
I would say it's an individual preference. I'm comfortable without PFCL.
Yes.
I peel usually, but again, it's a totally surgeon's discretion. How comfortable you are. I think the way you are trained, the way you can practice. The bottom line is you want to take out ILM around that particular macula, but not as a routine. All PVR cases are I do not remove ILM if there is no macular hole. I don't do that.
No.
Yeah. But yes, macular hole is there. Definitely, I would.
Mahesh sir will be speaking upon intraocular proliferation and reproliferative vascular membranes.
Dr. Saranan, any comments, any additional?
So one thing is like about the immature membranes. So one thing is now, as sir said, the tendency to wait is now not there. So sometimes I go in within like 2-3 weeks or even 1.5 months to see if any immature membranes are maturing up, and under oil just peel them without going for a full-fledged surgery. Just when you start visualizing the membranes, just go in under oil with the oil inside, two-port vitrectomy, and just peel these newly matured membranes which were left over in the first surgery because of lack of proper identification.
It's better to deal with them much earlier before it
creates an RRD.
So I'll be speaking about anti-hyaloid and reproliferative vascular membranes. So the definition of VHF proliferation is not very distinct or not very clear. So I have described them in three or four different ways. So VHF proliferation can be post-trauma. Post-trauma is the glial proliferation which happens at the site of the globe perforation and grows inside into the eye. It can be starting from the sclera into the retina, into the choroid. And post-RD surgery, you have this thick anti-hyaloid proliferation which forms in the vitreous base. And this is particularly common in myopes. I don't know why it happens, probably because of peripheral anti-segment ischemia, which makes these eyes proliferate so badly that we may lose some of these eyes to ptosis. And a little distinction is anti-hyaloid fibrovascular proliferation, which forms after diabetic vitrectomies. So here the vascular component is pretty high, and they tend to bleed. And these eyes can be lost very easily as well. So all these will have some amount of vascularity, but the diabetic patients seem to have much more vascularity. Not only diabetics, even a central little vein occlusion or a BRVO, you will find this vascularization at the vitreous space to be pretty high. So how do we identify these patients? So there are some clinical clues when the patient comes for a follow-up. Many of them will have this episcleral or conjunctival congestion, particularly at the site of the sclerotomy. So you'll see the proliferation starts at the sclerotomy, goes inside, and goes circumferentially. And these are patients who have recurrent vitreous hemorrhage, not in the early vitreous, not in the early postoperative period, about a month or 6 weeks later when they come with the vitreous hemorrhage, then we tend to think that they may have a sclerotomycete proliferation, and which may go on to form an antihyoid fibrosis proliferation. And later cases, they develop rubiosus iridis, a positive synechiae, and ultimately they go on to develop iris retraction and hypotony. So what are the issues? If you leave these eyes alone, they go into phthisis. And in gas-filled eyes, what happens is like they tend to progress faster because the detachment and the hypotony tend to progress faster, so better to intervene early. And if in the primary surgery we have filled the eyes with oil, then like it kind of masks the progression of this disease. So we don't tend to see that like they have developed this antihyoid proliferation much later. And like when we take them up for surgery much later, it can be kind of irreversible changes. And when would I not operate if the patient has a visible retrolental membrane? Asking the patient look this way and that way, and through the slit lamp, we find this thick tissue which is growing behind the iris. And with long-standing hypotony, I would probably not operate because these eyes either way will land up with hypotony. Let's look at some of the clinical scenarios as to how to manage them. This is a small, this young child with recurrent RD because of juvenile X-linked retinoschisis. So what we see here is the fibrous tissue growing onto the pars plana, very, very close to the ciliary body, ciliary process. The patient is phakic. So in a phakic patient with a thin lens, we can go ahead and remove this fibrous tissue pretty easily without touching the lens. The key is that the lens is not thick, and the correct the amount of depression and correct amount of suction, we can go ahead and remove this scar tissue without touching the lens. So this is a post-trauma localized proliferation, and this proliferation is at the site of the globe rupture. So here we are able to remove this fibrous tissue completely, and there's not a very severe case. You can see this scar tissue is not attached to the iris, not attached, not extending posteriorly as well. So you can isolate the whole scar tissue with the scissors and then remove them. And so this, what we see here is the edge of the retinectomy, which is pulling up the retina. So you can remove this scar tissue completely. Then go ahead and reattach the retina. The clue is like you can see the iris is still round, the pupil is still round, it is not dragged down that side. And if it is dragged down that side, that means like the ciliary body in that region would also be scarred down. So the much more serious epiretinal proliferation, one-eyed patient post bomb blast injury. There was an occlusive pupillae, and the scar tissue is growing from here posteriorly. And you can see this thick scar tissue. So extending nearly about like 3 to 6 quadrants, you can see the inferior retina is pulled up as a kind of a TRD. So the epiretinal membrane is being removed, and you can see the fovea is dragged towards the 6 o'clock. And this is the fibrous tissue which is grown causing the TRD. So we do a retinectomy there, isolate the retina from this scar tissue, and then go around and see if we can remove this scar tissue, how much we can safely remove. So in the process, I find that there is a foreign body within the scar tissue also, so which we remove. And may not be able to remove it completely, but isolate it at least so that it doesn't grow circumferentially. I usually cut off the ciliary body on either sides of the scar tissue, stopping it from growing circumferentially. So we'll be able to attach the retina, but if this scar tissue, if we are not able to isolate it or not remove it, it tends to circumferentially proliferate, giving rise to persistent hypotony. So here we see the very often, like not very often, we'll be able to remove this scar tissue completely. So this is the fibrous tissue which is grown over the ciliary process. We're able to dissect it off the ciliary process and remove it. And then like we find that it'll be attached to the iris as well and dragging it down. So we have to remove the iris from this scar tissue and also see if this scar tissue can be removed off the ciliary process completely. Very often the ciliary body is already damaged. So even if we remove it, the IOP may not improve, but we should at least try. You can see that it's stuck to the iris. We are removing the scar tissue from the iris. Another clue will be if we have put an oil, the PI will get closed. If we find that the PI is getting closed, then again we expect that the scar tissue is growing right behind the iris. So extreme depression, isolating the scar tissue. You can see the PI is closed in this patient, and that's because the scar tissue is grown right behind the iris, and that is what is being peeled right now. Isolate, remove it from its adhesion to the retina and remove it. So not very advanced because the pupil is still round in this patient. So here again, this is not too advanced, but the scar tissue, you can see very severe anterohyaloid proliferation, so thick that even a 20 gauge cutter will not cut. So with a bimanual dissection, we have removed this tissue from its attachment to the ciliary process. And there's no way I'm going to remove it. So make a section in the limbal section and remove this through the limbus itself. So you can still attempt because, as you can see, the iris is still not retracted. Once the iris retracts and goes back, the tissue is so densely adherent, we may not be able to remove it. But here, because the iris is still round, the scar, it is not progressed to involve the iris as the ciliary body, can still remove it. A couple of words about the diabetic reproliferation. Diabetic, I think Dr. Saravanan is going to speak to us, but then the reproliferation is not the same as regular proliferation of PVR or a regular diabetic vitrectomy. Here again, it's very densely attached and it's vascularized again. So if you find a reproliferation in a diabetic patient, we may often have to do a bimanual surgery, and it may be sometimes more difficult than a primary diabetic vitrectomy. So it's not like an ERM where we just go and peel it off. So in a diabetic patient with a TRD or a combined retinal detachment, if there's a reproliferation, we should be planned to do a bimanual surgery and also expect that these will be vascularized. This is one of the diabetic patients. You can see there's an extensive reproliferation, which part of it we are able to remove with the, like how we would peel an epiretinal membrane, but very extensive proliferation. And so as I mentioned, sometimes we may have to do a bimanual dissection in these patients. But what happens to the periphery, let's see. So this is what I was mentioning. As we go to the periphery, this is the posterior pole, we are able to attach it, but then peel all the membranes. But here, you see this thick, broad band of tissues, the whole vitreous base is become one thick tissue of fibrosis proliferation. This is something which we may not be able to remove at all. And in the process of trying to remove it, will cause more harm than benefit, because the choroid may get detached, the ciliary body may get detached, or the ciliary body irreversible trauma we may be inducing into. Difficulties in dissection, yes, we would have to do extreme depression like this and remove them. And very often they are vascularized and they may bleed from this fibrous tissue or from the ciliary process itself. And we may land up like this. The view becomes very hazy because of bleeding. And the blood may seep behind the detached retina because we have done a relaxing retinectomy, and the blood may seep behind the retina. So we'd have to wait, and these bleeders cannot be cauterized. So what best would be to do is to stop the surgery, elevate the bottle height, and wait for it to stop bleeding, and then go back inside, remove the blood, and track the clot and leave it in place instead of removing them. In very select situations, and if it is extremely adherent and I am unable to remove it and there's a peripheral traction retinal detachment, I will shorten the sclera instead of removing the fibrous tissue from inside. So create a scleral bed and shorten it. This is a very old surgery described by Skipens for anterohyaloid proliferation. This is something which very rarely I do if there is a peripheral TRD in a one-eyed patient and I am unable to remove this at all. These are some of the issues. Iris retraction and silicon oil keratopathy can be there. And you can see the iris is retracted here. I expect this will proliferate and the oil can come into the anterior chamber. So you can do a pupilloplasty to make sure that the oil doesn't come into the anterior chamber in these patients. The single pass technique, we should be able to close this and create an inferior iridectomy as well. So these are to be anticipated and done much before we take these patients for surgery, so that they don't land up with silicon oil keratopathy. And when we have patients like this where the whole iris is retracted or lost, we can do the silicon oil retaining sutures. These do retain the oil behind in many of these patients. The other option would be to put an aniridia implant, which we don't get that commonly. So you can place these sutures in place so that the oil is retained and the cornea does survive to a reasonable extent. To summarize, AHF proliferation is serious and often irreversible. Post-trauma, probably salvageable. These eyes are post-RD, possibly salvageable, depending on the extent of the fibrous tissue proliferation. Post-PDR, most often lost, though you may be able to attach the retina and they may be able to get the vision, but then like the cornea does go in for a 6 over time. Anatomical success is very often possible. Irreversible ciliary damage, however, results in irreversible hypotony, iris retraction resulting in keratopathy. Thank you very much.
My issue is diabetic eyes recurrence. Generally, they are associated with vitreous hemorrhage, recurrent vitreous hemorrhage. What is the role of anti-VEGF in that group? It just as a like a by time or there is a definite role as a treatment?
No, very often these people have rubiosis iridis, and in addition, this tissue which is vascularized and growing is very vascular. To aid the dissection, I would give an anti-VEGF and then operate them about 4 to 5 days later.
Yeah,
but I would not use anti-VEGF as a treatment for these patients.
Because a lot of time, that's what I wanted to drive the point, because recurrent heme, just keep on giving anti-VEGF, keep on giving, it's not, anti-VEGF is just to buy some time. Anti-VEGF, what you do, its problem is ischemia. And unless you have a definite treatment, only anti-VEGF will not work this type of ice. You have to go in, whether you want to try ARC, like anterolateral cryopixie later on. UBM is very, very helpful in these cases, actually. You can just identify this. And probably sometime we just dissect the membranes, what Mahesh has shown. Even sometime do cryo and laser, even laser on the pars plana as well. Because these are the desperate situation. You're just trying to save the eye. And sometime it works, sometime doesn't work.
I call upon Saravanan, sir, for his talk on diabetic proliferation, which includes primary and second membranes.
So thing is, when you're dealing with the proliferative diabetic retinopathy, sometimes we see that there are multiple membranes present inside the vitreous cavity, and reaching to the last membrane just before the retina, that is critical to your ease of surgery as well as your lesser number of complications and finally the successful visual outcome. Sometimes navigating these membranes is not very easy. So the before, like here you have a patient with a lot of vitreous hemorrhage, before you make a plan on how to go about doing a vitrectomy, you have to clear the vitreous cavity and the subhyaloid space to make sure this is the anatomy and this is where I'm going to start, start my surgery, trying to pick up membranes. So this sort of mental plan should be there. If it's already a clear view, probably you can make this plan either in your OPD when you're seeing the patients or just about when you're starting to do your vitrectomy, you can make it. So once you enter into the subhyaloid space, so first you start with the subhyaloid, just maybe cut through the, cut through the vitreous into the subhyaloid space. Once you reach the subhyaloid space, then next very critical step is to identify the second membrane. So this is going to be a very critical step because unless you do that, you're going to have a very difficult surgery with multiple complications. So now we are trimmed off the posterior hyaloid till the edge of that membrane which is present there. So chronic, so once you reach there, so this is a very little bit difficult situation where the membrane is totally adherent and you're using a pick to identify the membrane. So sometimes PVD is not there, like in this case where there's a small combined mechanism RD, and we have to induce PVD by using your little bit of localized traction using either a forceps or a pick. Like in a maxillary hole, you cannot use the hole cutter to induce a PVD. So here you're using a sharp bent needle so that it's easier to pick up and scratch this surface of the vitreous, so that you can induce a localized PVD, and then this suppression can be made into a rent by the cutter, and this gap can be widened as you go either superior or inferiorly or towards the macula as you keep on peeling the membrane. So now that is the area where the PVD has been induced. Once that is done, then you can use a cutter to make a small rent in that hyaloid and reach the sub-first membrane plane. So this will be the where you will start identifying the second membrane. So now using cutter. So this second membrane is just below the PVD, and it can be usually seen near just out around the epicenters where the neurons tend to rise from the retinal surface, and mainly seen in diabetics and other proliferative disorders also. Importance, as I told you, is critical to success. just showing some OCTs to demonstrated point. As you can see here that, so this, you can see this is the PVD here, and this proliferation which extends onto the retinal surface. Sometimes it's very thin and very invisible, so a lot of times you tend to miss it actually. Again, you see here, this is the primary PVD, and you can see the second membrane running across the surface of the retina here. Sometimes it runs across from macula to macula, and that may be a problem. Unless you identify and remove it, after 2-3 months, you'll see a dense ERM forming all across the macula. So again, showing multiple examples of the membrane running along the alongside surface of the retina. So when you're doing a surgery, you should not do your delamination technique at this level. So we are going to start your delamination technique at this level, that's going to end up with multiple retinotomies and significant bleeding, which will not be easy to control. So you have to identify this edge of the second membrane, start lifting it up, and this is the actual surgical plane underneath which all your delamination technique, either using your scissors or your forceps, is supposed to be done. So sometimes I told you the second membrane can be quite loose. So just with the suction of the cutter, you can see this membrane is getting lifted up, and you can see that the second membrane which is coming up. So now, what looks like a single tabletop plaque can become multiple small epicenters once you reach a sub-second membrane plane, and you can see the gap opening up between the membrane and the retina. So this will be possible only when you're under the sub-second membrane plane. Also, sometimes in these cases where it's not always easy to pick up these membranes because sometimes it's totally adherent. Here you can see once you reach the trim off the vitreous there, then you're using a sharp pick to elevate the, so sometimes it's quite invisible. So once you start stroking, you'll see that membrane is lifting up. And once you identify that, then you can use your forceps to peel it towards the epicenter. And once you reach the epicenter, either you can do a delamination with the cutter itself, or if it's very stiff and tough, then you may have to use your scissors to carry on with the surgery. So that is the area where you can see that's the second membrane which is coming up. And once you reach the point of where the new cells arise, that's going to create a lot of resistance. If it's tough, we can use scissors to minimize the trauma to the retina. Otherwise, the retina tends to get torn if you're using the cutter directly. So there's one more case example just showing the how to identify the second membrane because it's quite invisible. I'm not sure some people use either use tramsulin or some of the stains to identify, but it's not easy to stain. These membranes are not easy to strain. So again, you're seeing the induction of the PVD. And here you can see there's a membrane which is encompassing the disc and fovea. And here I'm trying to use a sharp pick to elevate. So you can see the retina getting pulled there. So that will indicate we are close to the attachment of the edge of the second membrane. So I'm trying to release the attachment there. So I release that attachment there. So once I have a free edge, then I can move on to my forceps. It'll give you a better grip and a more focal, the force can be a little bit in the direction you want. So once you do that, then you can use your forceps to deal with that membrane. So this is very critical, as I told you. And sometimes membranes on the disc can be a problem. So here is a very thick membrane, so there's no very difficulty in identifying the second membrane. But sometimes the membranes are so transparent and so small, and if you're not using the identification process, then you're going to pull, cause a lot of traction on the vessels just around the disc and macula. Either it can be the normal articular venule, or sometimes the NVD or retina can tear. Here you can see that here there's a small, this is the leftover membrane here, but the actual second membrane is slightly extending beyond that. So if I directly pull from this membrane, I'm going to create a lot of traction both on the retina as well as the arterioles and venules in that area. So I'm using a sharp pick to just lift off that edge. As you can see, you can see that it's coming, you can a little bit visualize when it comes across in the inferior part. You can see that it's coming up. So once you lift up that membrane, so this bit of the membrane, superficial bit of the membrane will come off without any significant damage to the underlying retina or the vessels. Otherwise, if you have a rupture of the arterioles or venules, it's going to bleed significantly, causing a lot of trauma, as well as sometimes you may not be able to progress proceed with the surgery. Sometimes small pegs in the mid-periphery can be a problem. You can see the second membrane just flowing across when I use my pick to peel. So what looks like a small plug-like addition, once you lift up the second membrane, it will become some 4 or 5 points of epicenters, which can be easily navigated with your forceps or scissors or cutter. So now that's the membrane which is flowing across. This membrane, second membrane can be a small extension around the actual first membrane, or it can extend way peripheral also. So you'll have to identify how far it is going and then do that. So then second will be the reproliferation. This is the patient who has already gone vitrectomy, but you have started to develop a small lamellar macular hole here. This membrane was not there in the immediate post-operative period, but you can see that new cells have started to develop after the surgery. And this is causing, this is the membrane where it's causing the retina to fold and creating traction on the fovea, creating a lamellar hole there. So this is a traction from this point causing the lamellar hole there. Sometimes this can be a cause its effects on, as a tractional effect causing either a TRD or lamellar or full thickness macular hole, or it can lead to multiple episodes of recurrent bleeding inside the postoperative vitreous cavity, recurrent multiple recurrent bleeding. This is the OCTA showing the presence of the neocell there. It's a reproliferation, which is not there in the initial part. I'm just showing the superimposition of the OCTA on the red-free photograph to show the location. So the reproliferation can develop from either as a de novo process, or it can develop from the leftovers which you leave, residual membranes you left over in the first surgery. So this is just showing the small membrane here, which was grown afterwards. So I'm just, this caused localized traction on the disc here. It's not very clear, but you can see this is a newly grown membrane there. So again, because there's no leftover vitreous to hold this and pull it, so your surgical techniques is going to be a little bit more difficult. You'll have to lift it up. And a lot of times when the membranes are very strong, you may have to use bimodal techniques to avoid trauma to the retina. So once we can lift it up and then relieving the traction. So there was a lot of considerable edema happening in the foveal zone. So this one more case, I'm showing how freely it is that the naked vessels are growing here. Again, this is a recurrent cause for recurrent episodes of vitreous recurrent vitreous hemorrhage. You can see that is this is the leftover membrane which was from the first surgery. You can see the proliferation happening here. You can see it's a naked network of free vessels, no tissue at all. So this was the reason why the patient was getting multiple recurrence after 4 or 5 months after the primary vitrectomy. Leftover membrane here and a new proliferation happening from this area. So this can happen when there is a very actively vascular disease process or because of inadequate laser, and that can be a complication of this. So again, we can trying to peel it off and then trying to laser extensively and cauterize also. So this is one more case where we had a lamellar, hole. And you can see this membrane usually when it's adjacent to the disc, you'll see that there's a disc, this NVD is feeding into this membrane. Even though it may be a NVE, usually you'll have a communication on the disc. So once you rupture that, the vascularity of this membrane will come down. And you can see there's a traction there with the lamellar hole there. So once we peel that membrane from there, you can see the rupture, the vessel causing some bleeding there in the NVD. Sorry, it's a little bit more brighter than what I see here. So I'm trying to do a inverse flap to cover the lamellar hole. I think I made it a full thickness during the surgical peeling. So I just made an inverse flap to help the macular hole close. So managing these membranes, you should be very, don't try to remove the whole membrane because it's very strongly adherent and sometimes very vascular also. So you have to be a little bit stingy, trying to address only the components which are causing either traction or very vascular. And a lot of times if there is very significant adhesions, use bimodal technique. And for the initial step, always use a sharp pick because the retina is totally, the membrane is totally adherent to the retina. And because the increased risk of bleeding, don't operate under oil because under oil is very difficult to manage the bleeding, either to wash off the blood or cauterize also. A lot of times I use anti-VEGF to decrease the vascularity. This one case referred from one of my colleagues. He told me that after the initial surgery, there was a large premacular and large blood clot, which sort of fibrosed to form a membrane. This was referred around 1.5 to 2 months after the initial surgery. I think more than 3 months, I guess. So it formed a big membrane. Just showing the depiction of the bimodal technique to avoid making multiple retinotomies. It's quite tough. And you have multiple adhesions and quite vascular, just pitted with the Avastin so that the bleeding is slightly more lesser. So you have to use bimodal techniques to totally remove it. Because it was causing large area of traction, I went for a total removal. But if it was only a small macular traction, I would have left over part of this. But this case was quite significant traction all over. So we were able to get away without producing any retinotomies. But I had to finally fill up oil because I felt that there will be a higher risk of bleeding in the postoperative period. I think we'll stop here. So unless you walk through this membrane, reach the retinal surface, your surgical complications is going to be high. And if you do this, you'll have a better success. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Saravanan, for the wonderful talk. Any questions or comments? Yes, please.
Regarding this membrane dissection, there is, I think, a role of reflux hydrodissection. So what is your opinion?
Yeah, that is available only in the Constellation by Alcon.
Yeah.
So this is useful when the membrane is a little bit loose, but the problem in our country is most of the patients come with in the very late stages of the disease where the membrane is really adherent. So this flow, and it's two things you have to make sure when you are doing this reflex flow dissection. One is the bottle height should not be high. It should be only 20 or 30, not more than that. If you are doing a tamponade, suppose there's a bleeding and you're trying to go for tamponade, the reflex will not work because already the internal intraocular pressure is very high. The flow will not be adequate. Second is to make the flow to the maximum, which is around 120 millimeters, I think. So the reflex flow should be the maximum. Third is the flow should be maintained for at least 2 to 5 minutes. It will not happen within a few seconds.
Yeah.
So you allow the flow to, and before doing this, you have to make sure the infusion, no, it's not covered with vitreous. Because when you insert the flow through this, the fluid has to regurgitate back into the machine.
Yeah.
If vitreous is clogging the infusion port, the fluid, the reflex is not going to work. So first is clear the vitreous nicely around the infusion port so that the water can flow back into the machine. Keep the reflex flow maximum, which is around 120. Keep the bottle height either 20 or 30, which is the maximum. Don't go for tamponade. And it has to work for at least 3 to 5 minutes for the, 2 to 5 minutes for the membrane to become loose. Helps in a little bit simpler disease. Does not work in most of our case, which, at least in the case which we see in our hospital, which come a little bit late in the stage and with the very adherent membranes and stiff membranes.
I agree with Dr. Sarvan. Somehow I try it because I read a lot of things. It's practically never worked with me somehow. Never worked with me. That is one thing. But also another thing is important. What happened is what is rightly mentioned. The fluid reflux is coming through the cassette.
Exactly.
So if you're using cassette for that one single case,
yeah,
then only you got the first case. The first case, if you're using new cassette, then it's safe. Otherwise, there's a risk of flowing to back again, and there's a risk of, though company says there are two chambers, then there is a barrier, and fluid comes only from first chamber, but there is always potential risk. So definitely, if you're reusing the cassette, I would say do not attempt.
Exactly. We have to change the cassette for each case.
If you're using new cassette, not even change. It's a new cassette.
Yeah, it's very difficult. Thank you.
Okay. I have one question for you, basically. If you have an iatrogenic break during membrane peeling, how you change your techniques, the direction of membrane peel, how you go around? As long as stiffness.
Yeah, yeah, if I'm going to do create a lot of traction in and out of the break, I usually change my direction to go to an area where the retina is still attached. But if it's only a small traction, then I continue to work in the same direction. The main thing is you want to avoid the retina becoming like a recumbent artery with the more bullous and very flappy retina. Then you'll have to use PFCL and surgery is going to get very, very complicated. So if you feel that you have to do considerable peeling in and around the break, move to a separate area where the retina is still flat and nice. If it's just a small 10 seconds of peeling, then you can carry on from the same side itself.
Yeah, you would probably have to work towards the break rather than away from the break. And sometimes you can use a viscoelastic to peel the hyaloid, which is very densely adherent. You can make a hole and inject viscoelastic very, very gently, not forcibly, because that can cause a break, and that can also help cleave the peripheral vitreous and induce the what you call the peripheral induction of PVD. I think they have one more question.
In a young diabetic, where the vitreous is still like, you know, the posterior hyaloid is still jelly form. It is not, it comes out piecemeal. What are the tricks for tackling that?
So in a very, especially in an IDDM patient, the young patient and very vascular disease, sometimes you see multiple layers of a sandwich. You have a very gel form, and even the membranes will have sort of 5 to 6 planes also. So you have to little bit wait slow, don't rush into the surgery. Sometimes you start pulling from the first GC layer only, then you'll end up with multiple tears. So keep your calm. It will take sometimes even 20 minutes to reach the second membrane, the surface of the retina. So keep your calm, go slow. Once you reach the retina, then it becomes very easy. So first to work through the top layers in a way. This happens only occasionally. It's not a common occurrence. It happens only occasionally. But try to keep a calm till you reach the surface of the retina. Don't hurry up into your peeling techniques till you reach the exact surface of the retina.
Diabetics, for those of you who are beginning, the more fundus details we are able to see, the more difficult the surgery is. So it's like we usually think the other way around. More fundus details we see, there's no hyaloid separation, so the more difficult surgery is. So we'll go on to the last talk,
yes.
Dr. Divyansh.
Okay. So, good afternoon, all. Thank you, sir. Thank you, all my mentors, for giving me the opportunity. So my topic is, can we have the presentation? So management of membranes other than diabetic cases, so a little more, I felt a difficult topic because there would be two types which I thought we can divide into. One is vascular membranes and one is non-vascular membranes. So non-vasculars would be more like secondary ERM for some other cause. Vasculars would be because of either vein occlusion, it may be associated with a CRD, a TRD, or a macular hole. Or it may be an association with having a CNVM because the primary surgery we had injured some blood vessel in that, or touched choroid, and that may be the reason. Or it may be because of secondary vasculitis, EELs, or some kind of peripheral the vasculitis also. So this would be the first video, as what we can see, a very flat proliferation. We can see this is secondary to some kind of a proliferative disease or a vein occlusion, as what we can see, and a very dense membrane. As you can see, wherever we are touching, there is a bleed which is occurring. So how to enter, where to enter, as what we were discussing, is to make a plane go as close to the retina and then start dissecting. So this is what we are doing, is using a needle and sharp dissecting at the areas where the membrane may be a little on the thicker side, so that you can brush it and try to identify a plane, and then using forceps and a focal traction, like you pull, leave, pull, and then again leave it. So don't keep on pulling, because there may be focal attachments and there may be focal vascular attachments. So as you can see, some areas it may peel off very easily, but at some areas, as you can see over here, there is a very dense attachment over here. And if, as what sir was also discussing, like over here, as what we think, there is probably a break, so come from the other side. So once, if the break is there, then we have to change the direction and peel towards the break. So this would be again a very dense proliferation, again because of the vein occlusion and causing a peripheral detachment. Very difficult to identify proliferation and retina, where the plane is. So attempt at various places, like here there may be a chance that we are below, but still we are not seeing a bare retina over there, and the retina is also getting lifted along with it. Probably some dissection, but we can start from outside. So rather than going from inside out, we can go outside in. There are having pros and cons, because the peripheral retina may be more thinner, more chances of break. But certain times we may be able to get close to the vintage point or go close to the retina and then dissect. Once we are in a correct plane, it peels off. Certain areas where there are focal nails or dense attachments, we can use scissors to dissect it. Again, as what we are discussing, pulling, leaving, and again pulling it if required. And if we see that there is a proliferation, then nicking using sharp scissors over there. So a sharp dissection, and we have to be open at this point for bimanual if we feel, because this was my mentor's video, I would have used bimanual in this case from the first step itself. So that's again probably a point. So as you can see, one membrane which is very densely adherent, again using a sharp dissection, and focal areas of attachment should be tackled, and then only try to cut the membrane out of it. Again, a very difficult case, vein occlusion with the macular hole with peripheral detachment, identifying exactly from where we have to peel. So again, in this case, we had opted for outside in, where we can see there are proliferations in the periphery also, which we are dissecting using scissors. In this case, because there was a macular hole, we couldn't identify any membrane as such, but once we were peeling, then we could identify there is some kind of an ERM which was near to this large macular hole. So as you can see over here, so some kind of a proliferation which has pulled this edge of the macular hole. So actually in this case is where there is a attachment at the fovea, sometimes you can revert it back over to the macula, and then this itself may act as a kind of an inverse peel, and that would close the macular hole. As you can see, this is post-op. This tissue which we have put inverted over there can be seen in the post-op. So this is, as Dr. Sarvanan was telling, post-diabetic vitrectomy, if you have secondary membranes, those membranes would be very densely adherent. As you can see, the whole retina is contracted and the membrane is extending far deep and also very anterior, not what we can see, that just TRD over here, it's extending far anterior. So to identify the secondary membrane, still in the secondary proliferations, there may be secondary membranes. As you can see, I'm trying to identify the plane where exactly
So by using a sharp pick or either a needle or a bent needle to identify exact plane, as you can see, clinically we are unable to identify, but when we dissect, when we try to use a sharp instrument, we see the secondary membrane extends far anteriorly. So that gives us again a vintage point, go below the secondary membrane so that the complications would be less. Again, as what we were discussing in diabetic cases, there may be very dense focal attachments. As you can see, I'm unable to peel beyond this. So I had converted to using, so as you can see, the retina is very tightly adherent over there, and I would not be able to peel. So using a bimanual approach, holding it with one hand and then identifying the place where it is densely adherent and giving a nick over there. So as what we can see, which was looking very dull kind of a membrane, is actually very vascular. So in diabetics which land up with secondary proliferation, we have to be careful. Anti-VEGFs pre-op if we feel that it is really vascular, but in this case clinically I didn't feel like, but post-operatively we could manage it well without causing any iatrogenic break. If we have a peripheral proliferation, we are unable to dissect it, as what you can see over here, very anterior, and either we can change hand, use the same hand over there, this because being a phakic patient I cannot cross and go to the other side, or either we can use a segmental buckle over there. So this is, I'm using the same hand, but still I'm unable to do it. Very anterior proliferation, which is there. So placing a segmental buckle would also be one of the options over there. So this is a case of an Eales disease where there are proliferations extending from the posterior pole and periphery also. Again, same, because the disease works in the same way, we have to identify the secondary membrane. So once we've identified the secondary membrane, then the peeling would be easy. And clinically, it may not be visible, but again, using a sharp instrument to dissect around and go towards the membrane, and then either using cutters or scissors, we can dissect that out. In this case, as what we were discussing in the peripheral, if it was an inadvertent break over here, so I had to relieve the traction, and the anterior vitreous also should be relieved from there, so doing a cautery to identify if at all there is any anterior vitreous also left behind, and then doing a laser. Very rarely we may sort to this doing an RR, but supporting it with a buckle would be a better idea. So this one-eyed patient, which I did surgery, but post-operatively still the retina is detached and there is some kind of a proliferation over here. As you can see, there is subretinal blood. Also, post-operatively, within a month, the retina is not attached. So the primary cause was this membrane, which is pulling onto the retina. Very thin, already there are breaks over there. So there may be certain patients where we may have touched the choroid and that may have caused some kind of a proliferation with the blood clot. So managing this blood clot would be, because this was a one-eyed and this was far posterior, I had to do membrane peeling as much as possible using sharp instruments, but still after this the retina is not attached. So doing a very segmental RR or a focal RR at that point, see, as you can see, it's very close to the fovea, so I'm cutting the retina using cutter away from the fovea with the cutter, but when I have to cut close to the macula, I'm using scissors, so that gives a little controlled cut at that point. As you can see, it's extending below the retina, that blood clot, and some kind of a clot which is densely adherent to the choroid. So even after my best cauterization post-operatively, there was still a clot which was there. So these are non-vascular membranes post-block perforation. As you can see, the inferior part, there is a block perforation. Again, identifying the secondary membrane in these cases are also important. Focal attachment inferiorly and extending over posteriorly. So again, using a sharp instrument to identify, as you can see, even with tricot, this area is stained. So this is far away from the primary membrane. So trying to identify or look for secondary membranes would be what we need to do in this cases, and then clump it at one point and then use cutter to remove it. So this was the video which sir was mentioning about. This was a post RD surgery retina was attached 3 months later. I removed oil. One month later, she came with a recurrent detachment. At one point, I could see some glistening. So I could peel that using a sharp instrument and then forceps. But I think I was not sure because this kind of a similar appearance was there at multiple places. And I was unable to peel at those areas. So again, this is after using tricot in the first case, first primary surgery. So this is what, as sir was talking about, we can use a PVA sponge, the Merosil sponge, then cut it using a 25 gauge instrument. You can go through the 23 very easily. And then you can mop it, as what sir was discussing. You can mop the retina. So in this case, as you can see, the vitreous is still over here. So that is, we can identify the edge of the vitreous also very easily till where we have peeled. This membranes, as you can see, I may be too rough, but still there are no complications as of like tears or breaks because of that. And you can keep the sponge over there, and then if you require to again use it, you can again use it. And it can very easily be removed with your cutter also. So this is this was the area where the vitreous was adherent. So that sponge can very easily be eaten up by the cutter. The last slide, you may have had cases where already you have undergone, did a vitrectomy for endophthalmitis. Under oil, there may be multiple proliferations. Again, these kind of proliferations are very, very difficult to manage because the retina is very thin, ischemic. You try to peel, the retina would tear. In rare cases, it would require doing an RR at the area where we are unable to peel the proliferations. So as you can see, this is at various levels, at various depths, this kind of proliferation may extend. So we can trim it, keep it as minimal as possible. Okay, thank you.
Any comments or questions?
I think I had done a good job, good surgery, I would say, because believe me, these vascular occlusion membranes are the most difficult membranes to remove. By diabetics are much easier compared to retina is ischemic there. Membranes are almost flat, quite a few patients. They do not have PVD at all, and they look very, very avascular. But the moment you start dissecting, they bleed like mad. And this is probably one condition. You have a pre-retinal vitreous hemorrhage, pre-retinal blood, intra-retinal blood, and subretinal blood. Everywhere you can have. These are the situations that are extremely difficult. I think a good presentation. Actually.
Thank you, sir. Sir's help, sir.
The thing was, how did you get that idea of using this? What's the name?
Vitreous wiping. It's a Merosil sponge.
Merosil.
PVA, polyvinyl alcohol sponge. Okay. But actually, this is not our idea. It was reported. It was reported in Act Ophthalmologica this year.
Okay.
So it is that they call the technique as vitreous wiping.
Okay.
So we picked up the technique and we have modified a little bit, and we have written actually a letter to the editor. They have what they have done is they have used
Wiping sponge they have used.
They have not picked it up from ophthalmology.
Okay.
But we have picked it up when we looked at it, it's the same what the LASIK surgeons used to dry the thing. So we used that. And then removing it, they have used a 20 gauge sclerotomy. So they have not used it through a trocar canal system. So what we did was we thought we'll use a negative action forceps. Negative action forceps will hold it.
Uh-huh.
And so
squeeze it.
So we don't have to squeeze it. One is that. Second modification, which we have described, which have written a letter to editor, is you don't have to remove it back.
Cutter.
You can cut it, use a cutter and remove it off. And quite useful for this peripheral.
I use the finesse loop, but I think it's quite expensive. So it works in the same way, but because with Thanos, I was not very happy. I feel better with the finesse loop.
This is quite okay because it's got that rough surface on the surface, but it doesn't seem to hurt the retina. Their publication, they have shown that OCT, there's no damage.
Okay.
DRG, there's no damage.
HFA also.
So it is quite safe. But of course, we cannot go dig into the retina, but on the surface, we can keep it and engage the vitreous and use it to peel it off. And immature membranes, you can use it to peel it off also.
So the ILM, it doesn't, as sir had also written to them, that it doesn't peel the ILM. But for the vitreous, the immature membranes, it's able to clump them at one place, like you wipe it and then it, they would be there and then you can peel it.
Yeah, it gives an edge, edge to peel it off, and you can kind of like literally wipe it towards the periphery. You can use it quite easily, and it's commonly available device, and it's not expensive to use it also.
It comes in a sterile packing, which you can...
This is the same sponge what we use for LASIK, sir.
It's called a spear.
I have not seen that.
It's called a spear. Okay. So they use it to actually in SN we used to use it before the buds.
Okay.
Long time ago, we used to use it for drying the mud. Instead of the bud, we used to use this. When you put that, it'll swell up. No, the same previous.
Basically, it was used for glaucoma surgeries. If you dip it,
vitamin C,
keep it over there. LASIK, they pulled up later. So
the important thing was just hydrate it before, because
then
it swells up.
It'll be very rough.
You have to hydrate it before.
But once
then
you go
cut
in, it'll immediately hydrate.
No, that's what. Then it cannot go inside. So you hydrate it. Then cut it, then grasp it and go inside. So do these steps before we go inside. Take it inside.
Okay.
If there are no other questions, that brings us to the end of this instruction course. I thank all my co-instructors for a wonderful course. I hope that all of you enjoyed it. There's a guest lecture by Dr. Qureshi. I'm not sure if he's there. If we are not there, I think we leave early for lunch. Thank you very much. Yeah.